Hare Krishna. Thank you for coming today evening. And so today I'll be speaking on Krishna's moods in the Bhagavad-gita. And I'll take, basically most of us have heard the Bhagavad-gita many times, heard many classes on it. And the theme which I'll focus on is how through all the philosophy, the personality of Krishna comes out. The Bhagavad-gita is not just a book of philosophy. Yes, it is a conversation between two people. And both these people are having a very close relationship with each other. And their relationship and the moods that come in their relationship flavor. Flavor the presentation of the philosophy and the discussion thereof. So today I'll try to cover about 9 chapters, and tomorrow we'll try to cover another 9 chapters, depending on how, at what pace we can complete. So I will take one or two verses from each chapter and we'll zoom in on them and try to understand what is the mood of Krishna conveyed through that. So if we look at the first chapter itself, tatah shvetair hayair yukte mahati syandane stitau madhava pandavashchaiva divyau shankhau pradatmatuh. So the Bhagavad Gita is spoken by Krishna to Arjuna, but Krishna's entry in the Bhagavad Gita is very sweetly indicative of the mood of the Gita thereafter. So what happens? So first there is a description of the war field from Duryodhan's perspective. And the way the Bhagavad Gita's narrative frame or narrative angle is there, we could imagine, one way we could envision the Bhagavad Gita is that the Bhagavad Gita is like a verbal link. It's a verbal camera. So we have camera here. So I'll use the camera metaphor quite often while explaining the Bhagavad Gita. So the Bhagavad Gita begins by starting with first Dhritarashtra's camera. What is happening over there? Then it goes to Duryodhan's camera. And what Duryodhan speaks, he describes the soldiers on both the battlefield, both the sides of the battlefield. But he misses out one person. Who is that? Krishna. And that his missing out Krishna is very indicative of the material vision. The materialistic vision, it considers God, even if God exists, I think God is irrelevant. God is inconsequential. And as if to reinforce that vision, when Krishna appears in the battle in this Bhagavad Gita for the first time, he is in the position of not even a warrior, but a charioteer. Tatah shvetair hayair yukte. So how the description starts? Suppose if we have a movie going on, and in the movie there is some kind of action is happening, maybe some thugs, some hooligans are molesting someone, and the hero comes charging. Maybe the hero comes on a white horse in shining armor, or maybe the hero comes nowadays, they might be in a motorcycle or maybe in a car. So then when the hero's entry will be there, usually they will describe first the car, and then when the car door opens. And even in the movie, they might start the darshan of the hero from the foot. Okay. You show the foot and then you move up and then you show the face of the hero. So similarly here, in some ways similarly, but first the descriptions are tatah shvetair hayair yukte. First, the horses are described. There are white horses. Mahati syandane sthitau, and there is a magnificent chariot. And there on that chariot, Krishna is not the warrior. it like we have a entry of the hero, and then you find the hero is not in the car, is the chauffeur of the car. Now, if somebody is a big person, you might think they have a chauffeur, or and they have somebody driving them, or if there is an action kind of person, they drive their own car. But somebody driving someone else's car, you don't think of them as a hero at all, isn't it? But God enters into this Bhagavad Gita as a charioteer. And Marathi Chandane Sthitau Madhava Pandava Shaiva. Madhava and Pandava. There are many places in the Bhagavad Gita has this poetic alliterations. Now many different names could have been used over here. But Madhava, Pandava. So there the starting is alliteration, the A sound, and the end is alliteration, the V sound. So the references are Pandava, Pandava, Shaiva. And what do they do? Divyau Shankhau Pradadmatuho. So it is interesting, there is some hint given that Krishna is a special person. In the subsequent list of warriors that is described, it describes that Yudhishthira blew his conch, Bhima blew his conch. But it is not described that their charioteers blew their conches. Normally conches are blown by the warriors, not by the charioteers. But in this case, although Krishna is a charioteer, he is much more than a charioteer. And as it is described, he blew a conch. And that indicates the beginning of the war. Now Krishna's entry is in this very humble, unassuming position. And then that's where the whole narrative seems to be going. Arjun is about to fight the war, and just before the war begins, he has his bow upraised, but he says, Senayor Ubhayor Madhye Ratham Sthapayame Achyuta Yavadetan Nirikshaham Yodhukaman Avastitan. Please place my chariot in between the two armies. And I want to see who is there to fight. And Krishna does that. In the first chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna speaks only one word. He says, Pashyaitan Pandu Putranam. He says, Pashya, Bhishma Drona Samuktaha, Sarvesham Cha Mahikshitam, Uvacha Partha Pashyaitan, Samavetan Kuruniti. Krishna speaks only one word, see. So actually there are a lot of times when Arjuna says, I want to see. And Krishna says, okay, see. And now when he sees, now this, what happens? That the eyes are often the way to temptation and illusion. And the ears are the way to illumination. So for Arjun, he sees and he gets deluded. He has a desire to see. Now what does he actually want to see? It's not that he's expecting some new warriors to be there on the war field. Like say if a cricket match is going on, and then when the team are about to play, then each team will want to know who are the actual playing 11. Maybe they had 14, 15 players, out of which 11 are playing. So it's not like that. Except for Karana, everybody was playing over there. Karana had chosen not to play. So it's not going to be any new warriors over there. And if I wanted to see the military formation, oh yeah, he can see everyone's military formation. It is not that he has to come in the middle. So why does he want to come in the middle like that? Senayor Ubayor Madhye. Actually, he comes in no man's land. No man's land means the place which does not belong to either side. And actually, it is not a place of neutrality. It is a place of danger from both sides. Because it is a place, it's a disputed territory. So Arjun comes in the middle. And in from the middle he observes, because he knows this is going to be a great war, and in this war, who are all out there to fight so much? It's a mysterious desire that grabs him at that time. I want to see who is fighting over there. So it's that desire, when he has that indicates the beginning of his illusion. So now at one level, none of the Pandavas wanted the war. But somehow the war was unavoidable. So as soon as Arjun says, I want to see, Krishna says, see. And then significantly, Bhishma Drona Pramukta. What he sees, first of all, he says Bhishma Drona Pramukta. Now this can have two different meanings. One is Krishna took the chariot in the middle, but it was not in the middle, you can place it anywhere in the middle. Middle is a long line. He took it in the middle with right in front of Bhishma and Drona. Or it can mean that he took it in the middle, but as soon as Arjun saw, the first people he saw was Bhishma and Drona. But either way, what happened? What he saw was the most, could say, damaging for his determination. And immediately his perception changed. His perception changed. What happened is that he started thinking. Initially he was saying, no, Dhartarashtra se durbuddhe. Who are these people who are there to fight against, who chose to fight with this wicked Duryodhan? But immediately his vision changes. Svajanam hi katham hatva. How can I kill my own people? So earlier his vision was that they are the foolish, they are the people who are sided on the wicked Duryodhana's side. But now his own people. The effect of what we see on our consciousness can be enormous. Nowadays we are assaulted with so much visual imagery through TV, through movies, through the internet. And actually, scientists have found that what we take in through our eyes, nowadays many people have screen addiction. It can be video game addiction, it can be movie addiction, it can be this addiction. So they have found that for the brain, there is no difference between what we take in through our eyes and what we take in through our mouth or our blood. If somebody takes in a drug, say that's an addiction. I don't want to take anything into my body like that. Or if somebody takes alcohol or somebody takes some smoke. Now we understand these are physical substances going into our body and they can damage our body. Yes, that is there. The physical damage may be apart, but what we take in through our eyes, for the brain, the similar kind of stimulation comes up. And the brain wiring changes by that. That's why the stimuli that we take in from our eyes can also addict us. So the power of complete reversal of perception through the eyes is described right in the beginning of the Bhagavad Gita. And by the end of the Bhagavad Gita, we will see the power of a reversion of perception through the ears. So that will be come at the end. So the first chapter of the Bhagavad Gita is just the setting. And then when the second chapter starts, Krishna is initially in the mood of a friend. And in the mood of a friend, he says, Arjun, come on, buck up. Don't be like this. And he just tries to give a pep talk. Pep talk is, just come on, cheer up. So he says, Arjun, don't give in to this weakness. How have you given in to this weakness like this? Kutastva kashma lamidam vishame samupasthitam anarjushtam aswargyam akirtikaram arjuna kutastva kashma lamidam. Where has this come in you? So the idea is that you're not expected to behave like this. Where has this kind of contamination, this kind of weakness come in you? Now Arjun actually uses the word klaibhyam masmagamaha. Klaibhya is a weak person, an important person. Now Arjun feels this word like a verbal slap. For a great warrior to be called a klaibhya, to be called a weak or powerless person. It's like for a person who is scholarly, telling to them that, you're a fool. He says, I'm not being weak. He says, I'm actually out of compassion choosing not to fight. Now, although he may choose out of compassion not to fight, it's not just out of compassion. It's out of confusion. And what happens? He finally concludes, I don't know what to do. And see, normally, Krishna demonstrates, right? Normally, there is one thing which we are all very eager to give. Most people are not charitable. But regarding one thing, everyone is charitable. Can you guess? Advice. Advice. Everybody gives advice. Isn't it? So now, Krishna shows here, don't give advice unless you are asked. So when Arjun gives a decision, I will not fight. Yes, first he says, Visrujya sasharam chapam shokasam vignamanasaha. He puts aside his bow. He says, I will not fight. So now at this point, he is not asking Krishna for opinion. See, I'm not going to fight. And Krishna just gives a pep talk. Come on, don't give into this weakness. Now, although in one sense, Krishna, Arjuna's action in 1.46, the last verse of the 46th chapter, the last verse of the first chapter, and in 2.678, 9, 10, that action is the same. Arjuna again in 2.9 says, Nayotsyaiti Govindam Uktva Tushnim Babuva Nayotsya. I will not fight. But in between something is very different has happened. Arjuna, in between what has happened, he admits, I am confused. And because I am confused, he says, I surrender to you. Pruchhami Tvam Dharma Sammoodha Chetaha. So I ask you, what is Dharma? This is the key word over there. Generally, suppose we enter into a class and a question answer session is going on over there. And if we enter into the class after the question has been asked, then we are trying to figure out what is this going on over here. We hear this point, okay, this is okay, but what is going on? If we hear the question, then the answer falls in context and we can make sense of the answer. So, similarly, we need to, before we can understand the answer, the Bhagavad-gita is the answer. Before we can understand the answer, we need to understand the question. And the question is, Pruchhami Tvam Dharma Sammoodha Chetaha. So I want to know, what is Dharma? So he's not asking, should I fight or should I not fight? His question is much more universal. What is the right course of action for a human being? And that question is what makes the Bhagavad Gita universally relevant. So, when Krishna answers the question, he sees that Arjun is here asking a very serious question. And now somebody might say that, okay, you give me your opinion, I'll take your opinion, I'll go and take someone else's opinion also. And then I'll make a decision. Then, but Arjun says no. He says, no other solution is going to work. Nahi prapashyami mama panudyad yachokamuchoshanamindriyanam. He says, even if I go by the counsel of someone else, I fight and I win the war and I get prosperity as much as that of the heavens, that's not going to remove my grief. I need an answer, but what am I meant to do in life? So he gets this question primarily because at that time, Arjun is torn between two dharmas, his Kshatriya dharma and his Kula dharma. Kshatriya dharma is, as a warrior, he is meant to fight against aggressors. His Kula dharma, he is a member of the Kuru dynasty. So, as a member of the Kuru dynasty, he is meant to protect the dynasty. How can he fight against the members of his own dynasty? So, now in this particular situation, when these two duties pull him into opposite directions, he doesn't know what to do. So he is asking, Pruchhami Tvam Dharma Sammoodha Chetaha. Dharma Sammoodha is, see, we don't just need right values. We need a right hierarchy of values also. If we just, okay, this is good, this is right. But if there are two rights which are pulling us in two different directions, what do? We need a hierarchy of values. There is Taratamya. Taratamya is hierarchy in Sanskrit. So Arjun's question is, what is Dharma? When two duties are pulling me in two different directions, what should I do? And at that time, what does Krishna do? Krishna, first, Prahasan Iva Bharata. Krishna smiles. Actually, it is Prahasan Iva. It is as if he smiles. Now, why is he smiling? At one level, what is happening is amazing. Amazing. Why is it amazing? Because it's so utterly unexpected. Say, suppose a cricket match is going on. Say, India-Pakistan World Cup final is there. And just before the final is about to start, the toss has been done, the fielders are already in the field, the umpire is there, the bowler is about to start the run-up. And then at that time, the batsman is at the striking end. The striker calls the non-striker. And they come in the middle of the field. And they start talking. And they keep talking. And they keep talking. Now, everybody want to know, what is there so urgent to talk? Come on, play the match now. You can talk afterwards. So, right in the middle of the battlefield, when everybody is ready to fight, at that time, Arjuna asking, tell me about Dharma. So, it's such an amazing situation. Somebody might say, this is not the time. Somebody might say, hey, this is not the time for philosophy. But, actually, this is the time when philosophy can be heard the most. Because what happens? That is the time when we are on the border of life and death. At that time, we start thinking about bigger things. So, Krishna, when he sees how amazing it is, that this warrior Arjun has suddenly put aside his bow and wants to discuss philosophical questions. And Krishna is expert, the expert teacher. Now, nowadays, many teachers, they want to do what is called experiential learning. Take students to the field. Give them live learning, experiential learning lessons. So, Krishna in the Bhagavad Gita gives the ultimate experiential learning lesson. What does he do? He converts a battlefield into a classroom. So, and there, by his presence and presentation, he will rise to levels of wisdom that has rarely been seen before or after. And because such an amazing thing is about to happen, Krishna smiles. And then he begins his message. So when Krishna begins the message, what does he do? The first thing he tells Arjun is that learning begins with unlearning. Now what we don't know is not the problem. What we don't know but think we know, that is a far bigger problem. So, if we don't know, we'll ask and we'll learn. But if we think we know, then it is a big problem. So, this is what happens. So, Krishna tells Arjun, actually, the test of your education is in your emotion. It's a very deep point. The test of your education is in your emotion. If you are educated, your emotion should be educated. Education is not just about information. What do we mean by educated? The test of education is an emotion. Think of a doctor is going to do surgery. Now, the doctor may all have surgeon may have all the theoretical knowledge. Okay, I have to cut this body part like this, I have to do this, I have to do that. And the surgeon also knows that actually when I cut, although it will be a lot of blood, bleeding, but ultimately there will be healing. And the surgeon's education should be able to help him see beyond the blood to the ultimate healing. And if the surgeon becomes overwhelmed by that time, I can't do the surgery, so much blood, so much cutting now. Then actually whatever medical education they've got has not been assimilated. So what applies to a surgeon also applies to Arjuna over there. Kshatriyas have to fight. And sometimes they have to fight against people who may be dear to them also. So it's like the whole society is a body. And sometimes if some limbs get diseased, then those limbs have to be amputated. So the Kauravas were like the diseased limbs of the body. So Krishna's first point is that you think you are educated, but you are not educated. Because the test of education is in emotion. If our emotions are not changed, then whatever education we have got, that has not been assimilated. And then what is the education? It's interesting that Krishna doesn't give new information to Arjuna. When he says, Dehi no smenyatha dehe, that you are not the body or the soul. It is not that Arjuna has never heard about it before. Most of us, we may not have heard about it before. Or we may also heard but not really thought much about it. In fact, Arjuna also says in the previous chapter that Narakenyatam vaso bhavati ityanushushruma. I have heard that we'll go to hell. That we will go to hell and we'll live forever in hell if we destroy our own family tradition, if we destroy the dynasties. Now, who is going to go to hell? Obviously, the body is not going to go to hell. So, it's clear that Arjun knows that there is some part of us that is going to go to, is going to survive after death. So, actually speaking, insight comes not just by the getting the sight of something new. Insight comes by catching sight of the link between things that are already inside. There are things inside, I can see this, I can see this, I can see this. But insight means, oh, I see all these are connected. That's how. So again, a doctor says, and then we may say, oh, I got cough, I got temperature, I got weakness. Now for us, these are three different symptoms. But a doctor may say, oh, you got this disease. So the insight is to see the link between things already inside. So what is happening? Arjuna is asking about all these things. Oh, there is Kshatriya Dharma, there is Kula Dharma. What should I do? So the first thing is, Krishna tells Arjuna, you are not a Kshatriya, you are not a Kuru Nandana. So the fundamental point is, you are the soul. And begin from that point. So, Krishna starts by just changing the perspective completely. First, you are not the body of the soul. And Kshatriya is a role for you. Kurunandana is a role for you. But don't get so caught in the roles. Move to the fundamentals. And then, in the first chapter, it's very analytical. We often say the Bhagavad-gita is a text of bhakti. But you will see, Bhagavad-gita doesn't have so much emotions. You know, it's not that Krishna and Arjuna are dancing in ecstasy. Isn't it? No. If you see, most of the time, the Bhagavad-gita's bhakti is very, very different from Chaitanya Charitamrita's bhakti. Bhagavad-gita bhakti is more, you could say, almost say unemotional. It's Krishna telling Arjuna, just be equipoised. Sukhe dukhe samaye krutva labha labhau jaya jayau. So why is that? Because bhakti is not just so much about emotion. Bhakti, the essence of bhakti is dedication. Dedication to the service of the Lord. And in that dedication, emotion may also emerge. And if that emotion comes, that is wonderful. Many people say that the pursuit purpose of life is the search for happiness. Yes, at one level it is true. But actually, as devotees, our purpose is not to look for happiness. Our purpose is to look to serve Krishna, to express our love for Krishna. And happiness will come as a byproduct. Life is so serious. The world is such a terrible place in many different ways. There are so many problems in life that happiness is not a very substantial purpose to pursue. Because happiness can go away at any time. So the essence of devotion is dedication. And a byproduct of dedication is satisfaction. So happiness is best experienced not as a product but as a byproduct. Product means if I go and try to do the things, okay. Eating this will make me happy. Watching this will make me happy. You know, touching this will make me happy. Then, after some time, that happiness will lead to boredom. If not worse. Many times people get addicted because they are searching for happiness. So, the point is that Krishna is, for him, it's the search for happiness can often become the cause of the greatest unhappiness. So, the Bhagavad-gita's mood is search for service, search for dedication. And happiness will come in its way. But in the case of Arjun, it is his emotions which are coming in the way of his dedication. And that's why the stress of the Bhagavad-gita is, be unemotional, be equipoised. It is devotion, but it is devotion in which emotions are not allowed to come in the way. So in that sense, it is unemotional devotion. Not unemotional in the sense of no emotion, but rather no emotion that comes in the way. So in the second chapter, mostly it is, you are not the body of the soul. Therefore, stay unemotional between bodily ups and downs. And then, by the end of the second chapter, Arjun has heard so much that Arjun is overwhelmed. Is overwhelmed. Krishna has spoken a lot, but for Arjun, it's all the pieces have to fall together. So sometimes what happens, somebody might be speaking something, but for some the audience, sometimes what happens, if say if you are hearing a class and in the middle of a class we get a question, and then that question fills our mind, and then after that whatever is spoken, we just don't hear it at all, because that question was occupying our mind completely. So sometimes it happens, not exactly like that, but something similar happens. So Krishna is telling all this, that okay, this, be equipoised, be undisturbed by worldly emotions. Then Arjuna asks this question, okay, can you tell me the characteristics of such a person? And what does he ask? His question is also, Sita pragyasya ka bhasha, samadhistasya keshava, siddhi kim prabhasheta, kim asita vrajeta kim. So he asks, what language does he speak? Ka bhasha, how does he sit? How does he walk? Kim prabhasheta, how does he speak? Now, this might seem like a very curious question. Why would you ask, how does he sit, how does he walk? Arjuna is not asking about a person who is a fashion model, isn't it? And he's not asking for somebody to pass an English fluency test. How does he speak? Isn't it? So, there are times when things are not to be taken literally. Literal meaning can often completely confuse us. See, the Prabhupada is strong that the Kurukshetra war is a historical war. That's true. But the Bhagavad-gita is a Gita. It's poetry. And one of the beauties of poetry is that symbolisms are used. So, here it's clear. The question will make no sense if you take it literally. How does he sit? How does he walk? Well, what's going on over here? So, then Acharya explains, sitting and walking refers to actually, how does he restrain the senses? How does he engage the senses? And Krishna gives the whole answer. But for Arjun, actually when he is asking this question, his driving thing in his mind is, so should I be fighting or should I not be fighting? And he gives all this answer, and Krishna is telling repeatedly, Arjun was at the beginning of the Gita, he was in great agitation. Such agitation that he was crying in public. No, it's one thing to cry, it's another thing to cry in public. You know, even if we are overwhelmed by emotion, even if we start crying, even if we cry in public, we'll try to go in private and somewhere cry. Arjun was the emblem of masculinity. Kshatriyas are trained not to show any pain or any negative emotion in a war, because that will be seen as a sign of weakness by the opponent and will be exploited. So such a Kshatriya who's trained to hide pain is crying in public in the point of maximum visibility, which is in the middle of the two battles, the two armies. This indicates how much trauma he must be in. And so considering that trauma, Krishna tells Arjun that if you attain the spiritual state of consciousness, you will be peaceful. So Arjun is internally traumatized, and Krishna is saying, Sa shanti madhi gachati. But Arjun is thinking, hey, shanti means no war. So what happens many times, when I was studying public speaking a little bit, so I said that what happens is that when we speak, at best the audience gets 20%. And God knows which 20% it is. So, Krishna is speaking from the perspective, Arjuna, you are so agitated, you will calm down. Now what happens is that sometimes we are in a state of emotion, but we are not even aware that we are in a state of emotion. We are so caught by that emotion. He's thinking, Arjuna is thinking, I should fight, I should not fight. And when Krishna repeatedly says, Shashanti madhi gachati, you will gain peace, you will gain peace, you will gain peace. Then Arjuna asks, if you are talking about peace, then why are you asking me to fight? So, then Krishna starts, okay, let's rewind now. Let's rewind, okay. You know, Krishna says, okay, I talked about two levels. So basically, for Arjun, there is only two options. One is, either you fight and get bad karma, or you renounce the world and again, you'll be irresponsible. But at least you'll be acting in knowledge. So for him, action and renunciation are two options. But Krishna tells, These are not the only two options. Actually, there is action, renunciation, and in between there is action with renunciation. There will be act with a mood of detachment. And Krishna says that we are talking about different levels over here. And in the third chapter, the whole focus goes on action with renunciation. And then when he's talking about action with renunciation, Arjun asks a question. Each chapter, we don't have so much time right now, but each chapter, Arjun's question also reveals his mood. Till now, this is Arjun has asked the first question, Pruchami Tvam Dharma Sammood Cheta. The second question he asked was, Sita Pragyasya Kavacha. What are the symptoms of a self-realized person? The third question he has asked is, actually, you know, if you are talking about peace, why are you asking me to fight? Then the fourth question he asks is 3.36, where he says, Atakena prayuktoyam papam charati purusha anichchannapi varshneya baladivaniyojitaha. He says, what is it that makes us act wrongly? And when I first read the Bhagavad Gita, not the first, second time, first I had read when I was maybe 5-6 years old, I had read the Bhagavad Gita to memorize for a shloka recitation contest. But after I came to Krishna consciousness, first read the Bhagavad Gita, this was the verse that stood out. What is so striking? So many of us feel impelled to do something which we don't want to do, at least in our good sense. So, what is it that impels us to do wrong? So, Arjun asked this question because Krishna is talking about how we should stick to one's duty. And since how we should stick to one's duty, at that time, Arjun asks, but there is something which pushes us away from duty. What is that? And so when Arjun is hearing this question, now he's also thinking, am I being pushed away from my duty by something within me? So now if you see what Krishna answers is kama. Now kama doesn't necessarily refer only to lust. It can refer to lust. But if we see the question is, what makes us act wrongly? So it can be any self-destructive desire can make us act wrongly. So anyway, at this point, Arjun asks this question and Krishna answers. And this is karma. And then he says, this is an eternal enemy. As long as existence is there, the self-destructive desire is there. And then after that, he says how to overcome it. It's a whole battle strategy from 3.37 to 43. And then in 4.1, Krishna suddenly changes the scope. He says, I gave this knowledge long ago to the sun god. And immediately, Krishna, Arjun's 4.1, stop. You know, it's like, say, if we are watching some movie or watching some match, and something's, we're just watching and something suddenly happens. Hey, what happened over there? Just replay it. He says, hey, how could you speak to the sun god? Now, here what has happened is the first time in the Bhagavad Gita itself that Krishna's divinity is revealed. At one level, Shri Bhagavan Uvacha is there. But that Krishna is God is explicitly stated over here. There is a 2.61, there is one verse, actually not even one verse, one fourth of a verse. Tani sarvani sanyamya. Yukta asita matparaha. He says that not just that you should, Krishna is not just the teacher of sense control, Krishna is the object of the controlled senses. That's what he tells over there. Next chapter he says 3.30, Mai sarvani karmani sanyasya adhyatma chetasa nirashir nirmamo bhutva yudhyasva vigata jvaraha. There also indicates that Krishna is not just the teacher of karma yoga. He is the object of karma yoga. The karma yogi is meant to offer the karma, offer the work that is done to Krishna. So what happens is, when we do karma yoga for Krishna, Krishna takes the karma and gives us the yoga. So Krishna takes the karmic entanglement and gives us the yoga, gives us the connection with him. So mai sarvani karmani, offer this to me. So there are hints like that in the second and third chapter, but the fourth chapter, Krishna explicitly says that actually I descend repeatedly into this world. I am the Supreme. And by devotion to me, you can attain me. So, but at this point, Krishna, so from 4.4 is Arjuna's question, and 4.5 to 4.14 or 15, we can say Krishna tells about his position. But in a sense, that is a diversion for Krishna. And Krishna's main subject is Karma Yoga. So again, he comes back to Karma Yoga and starts speaking about Karma Yoga. And while all this is going on, Arjun is still having this question. Okay, Krishna tells about how if you get knowledge. Now the difference is third chapter, he said about how there is self-destructive desire within us, and by spiritual knowledge we can overcome it. And then after he talks about the power of that knowledge and how that knowledge can purify us and liberate us. And then Krishna, Arjuna is thinking, okay, Krishna has said to Arjuna also, tadvidhi pranipatena, you know, you have to go to a self-realized stage and learn from them. And then you have to cultivate this knowledge and then you'll get liberation. And Arjuna is thinking that maybe if I have to cultivate all this knowledge, then I won't have to fight. But then suddenly, at the end of the fourth chapter, Krishna tells Arjuna, tasmat ajnana sambhutam ritstham jnanasina atmana chitvainam samshayam yogam atishto tishta bharata. Therefore, with the sword of knowledge, rise and fight. The sword of knowledge. I say, hey, what's going on over here? So Arjuna asks, again, you know, if you consider knowledge better than action, then why are you engaging me in action that will lead to entanglement? Then Krishna again answers the question. Krishna says, yes, knowledge is also good, action is also good. But actually, by knowledge, by action done in knowledge, you can move forwards. You can move towards liberation. And then in the fifth chapter, Krishna talks about Karma Yoga in greater detail. And then he concludes, the one drop of bhakti in the fifth chapter is in 5.29. Bhuktaram yagya tapasam sarvaloka maheshwaram surudam sarvabhutanam jnatvamam shanti mruchyati. So here Krishna is telling, how can you get peace? By knowing me to be your well-wisher. If you understand that, if you act according to my plan, then you will get peace. Don't think simply by avoiding war you can get peace. Now peace comes not by simply avoiding conflicts. Peace comes by living in harmony with Krishna. That is a deep inner peace. So that connection with Krishna gives us a real security. Krishna is saying, if you have that connection with me, then you will be secure. Then in the sixth chapter, Krishna starts talking about how you can start practicing yoga to advance spiritually. So in the fifth chapter, the conclusion there is that Jnatva mam shanti mruchyati. You will gain peace. But what is this peace? This peace again comes through dedication to Krishna. Conviction that Krishna is our well-wisher. By doing Krishna's plan, that is where I'll get peace. In the sixth chapter, Krishna talks about Ashtanga Yoga, about going to the forest, doing meditation. And then, it's quite an intricate description. But at the end of it, Arjuna asks two questions. First question is, hey, this is too difficult. This is too difficult. Yoyam yogastvaya prokta samyena madhusudana etasyaham napashyami chanchalatva sitim sthiram. How can I see everyone equally? It's not practical for me. So now, what does Krishna do? And then next is the famous chanchalam himana Krishna. He says, I can't do this. But Krishna, what he does, first thing he does is, he empathizes with Arjuna. Yes, asamshayam mahabaho manodurnigram chalam. Yes, it is difficult. It is extremely difficult. There is no doubt that it is difficult. So what happens is, sometimes, even if we have to tell something which is unpalatable, now begin with something which is palatable. Begin with the fact that we understand them. Say, suppose we go to a doctor, we go to eye doctor, and we want to check our eyes. And as soon as we sit down, the eye doctor says, okay, this is your spectacles. What? No, you didn't even diagnose me. No, I know, take the spectacles. Now, if we don't feel the doctor has heard us, we won't be very ready to take the spectacles. Spectacles is relatively harmless. If somebody takes, okay, take this pill, then it's okay, no, I don't want to take it. Somebody says, okay, do the surgery. Hey, nothing doing. So what happens is, before we can understand, we need to feel understood. If the patient feels understood, yes, the doctor has understood my symptoms, then when the doctor gives the medicine, then the patient will take the medicine. Similarly, what first thing Krishna does is, tells Arjun, yes, I understand. So here we see Krishna's empathy. Now Krishna is the supreme and Arjun is saying, I can't control the mind. Krishna says, just buck up, control it. Krishna doesn't do that. Okay, I understand, it's difficult. Now after that, what he does is, yes, it's difficult, but it's possible. Manodurnigraham chalam abhyasena tu kaunteya vairagyena cha gruhyate. By abhyas, by study, by practice, it will be possible. And then he reassures him and moves on. So Krishna stresses that if you follow the right process, it is possible. Asanyatatmana yogo dushprapiti mehmati vashyatmana tu yatata shakyo vaptum upayataha. If you have the right process, you can do it. This is a very significant point. That process will be told later. Sometimes people think that changing for the better is simply a matter of willpower. We all have certain, our mind goes wild, our senses go wild, we often, our emotions go wild. So many times we think self-control is just a matter of willpower. And anybody who doesn't have self-control, that means they don't have willpower. Well, it's not that simple. Why? Because the way Krishna talks about, say, kama. Kama is, again I said, not just lust, but self-destructive desire. He says, it's not just a desire that comes up within us. It is like a contamination that is already present within us. So, lust or greed or anger, they are not just emotions. They are things that are present in our consciousness. And they shape our behavior in particular ways. So just by raw willpower alone, it may not be always be possible to control them. It's like, say, somebody's coughing a lot. And they decide by raw willpower, I will not cough anymore. to take another example, say somebody has got loose motion. They say, willpower. Now, willpower is required, no doubt. But willpower is required to regulate the diet, to take the medication. It is not just raw willpower that can cure a disease. It is willpower directed towards taking the treatment. That will cure the disease. Similarly, what Krishna is saying, that asanyatatmana yogo dushprapiti mehmati. If it is not following a proper process, it is impossible. Vashyat mana tu yatata shakyo vaptum upayataha. Upaya is remedy, treatment. So it is possible if you follow the right process. It's a self-transformation or self-improvement, changing ourselves, growing spiritually, is not just a matter of raw willpower. I do it, and I decide I'll do it, and I'll do it. But it is a matter of following a right process. And that process will be described later in the Gita. So then, Krishna is very reassuring over here. He's not judging. When we admit our faults to Krishna, we have to understand that Krishna is a very loving God. Krishna's purpose is not to catch us when we do wrong. Sometimes you think Krishna is like a judge. If I do something wrong, yeah, Krishna will catch me. Now, get this karmic punishment. It's not like that. Krishna's purpose is not to catch us when we do wrong. Krishna's purpose is to catch us when we fall. It's like a mother who is helping a child to walk for the first time. When, if the child while walking falls, the mother is not going to laugh at the child. The mother is going to run and catch the child. So Krishna's purpose is to catch us when we fall. So Krishna is on our side. Krishna is by our side, inside us. As he knows our weaknesses, he knows our faults. and he knows our struggles, he appreciates our struggles. Krishna says, asamshayam mahabahu. It's difficult, I know it. But if you follow the right process, it is possible. Most of the times, when we think that we want to, somebody has to change something. Why are you doing like this? Do like this. We often think it's simply a matter of, I told you to the way to do it, now do it. We think it's a matter of education or willpower. But most often, you know, a major part of education, especially with respect to learning something like skills, which we have to do, a major component of education is to give encouragement. Not just tell what to do, but give the confidence that you can do it. If we don't give that confidence, then even no matter how much we tell you that you can do it, you should do like this, do like that, but they will not be able to do it. So Krishna is telling Arjuna, yes, it's possible for you. It's possible. So this, giving encouragement is extremely important. We all, just as the body, if you say a car needs fuel, the human heart needs encouragement. Without encouragement, we just become so disheartened. Just can't continue on. So the sixth chapter, although at one level it is talking about very high levels of yoga, but another level, you see that Krishna, while talking about those high levels, he's also very encouraging. The next question also is a question of doubt, of hesitation. Now the fourth chapter, the doubt was more theoretically, how could you have spoken to the sun god? But here the doubt is more practical. One is, I don't think I can do this. The second question is, he says, what if I'm not able to achieve success? Okay, I may start off on the spiritual journey, and then what if I can't achieve success? He says that. He gives a very poetic metaphor over there. He says that there is a cloud, one set of clouds moving this way, one set of clouds moving this way. And one cloud leaves from here and decides to go there. But along the way, suddenly wind comes and sweeps the cloud away. Then what happens to this cloud? Na ghar ka, na ghat ka, as we say. Neither here nor there. So is it like that? Krishna, when he asks, so if somebody leaves, one cloud is the materialistic way of life, the other is the spiritual way of life. So is it that we will neither get material success nor spiritual success? We will be lost both ways? So Krishna tells, the first thing before answering the question, you know, address the concern underlying the question. Sometimes if there is emotion, there is fear, there is worry, then what do we have to address? To see an expert teacher doesn't just answer the question, it answers the intent behind the question. Understands the mood of the questioner and addresses the mood. So what Krishna does first is, here, when Arjuna is having doubt, apprehension, fear, then what does he do? First, reassurance. Parthanaivehanamutra vinashastasya vidyate nahi kalyanakrit kashchit durgatim tatha gacchati. So Arjuna, neither in this world nor in the next world, you will attain auspiciousness. Nahi kalyana krit kaschit. One who is engaged in good. Nahi kalyana krit kaschit. Durgatin tata gacchati. One will never attain an inauspicious destination. One who does good will never perish, Arjuna. Tata. Tata is a word of very great affection. Oh dear friend, oh dear Arjuna. Be assured that one who does good will never perish. It's a very sweet and categorical assurance. Never perish. And when we do this, that is the point when we encourage others. Now, if, say, a child is learning to walk and a child falls once, twice, thrice, four times, five times, 10 times, and the child has become disheartened, and a child asks the mother, and the child has fallen down also, little hand is, maybe the elbow is injured, the thigh is, the knee is injured. And the child asks, actually, will I be able to ever walk? No, I have fallen down so many times. You will have to fall down many times again. And if a mother says like that will be terrible. You will learn to walk. So there is, when a person needs encouragement, that's what we need to give. Once a devotee wrote to Prabhupada, say, Prabhupada, I'm such a fallen soul. And Prabhupada wrote back, says, I need many fallen souls like you to help me to spread Krishna consciousness all over the world. So when somebody is disheartened, at that time the first thing we have to do is give encouragement. And in fact the Bhagavatam says, in the third canto, that the great saints travel around the world assuring people of fearlessness in the Lord. There are many things to fear in this world, but when we are living in the service of the Lord, there is fearlessness. So Arjun is assured this. And then Krishna of course describes that, okay, if you can't complete in this life, then continue in the next life. Either you will be born in a devotee's family or you will be born in a well-to-do family. And either way, you will be able to continue and you will attain perfection. The sixth chapter is both very philosophical in terms of exalted levels of samadhi which I talked about, but it's also very personal in terms of how Krishna addresses the doubts of Arjuna. And then from the seventh chapter, there's a dramatic change in the whole emphasis of the Gita. The first six chapters are about what? Anyone knows?
Karma Yoga.
Karma Yoga. Actually, it's not just about Karma Yoga, it is a Karma Yoga leading to Bhakti Yoga. The middle seven chapters are about Bhakti Yoga itself. And that is indicated in the right first verse itself. If you see throughout the first six chapters, the whole discussion is be detached, be equipoised, be unaffected by worldly ups and downs. So the whole mood is about virakti, detachment. But the first word in the seventh chapter is attachment. Mai asakta manaha partha yogam yunjan madashraya. I once gave a seminar on the significance of each chapter of the Bhagavad. Each chapter's first verses, first word. You know, each chapter's first verses, first word is actually very indicative of what is going to come in that chapter. So, mai asakta. So, mai asakta manaha. So, Krishna is telling that you can make your mind attached to me. And he describes the process. So, till now, the whole point was about being detached from the world. So, the Bhagavad-gita shifts Arjuna's vision first from the body to the soul. And then action at the level of the soul. That's the first six chapters is Karma Yoga. But from the seventh chapter, the vision shifts from the soul to the whole, to Krishna. And now the stress will be on Krishna. That's why in the seventh chapter, it's all about Krishna's position. How great Krishna is. And how he permeates everything. When you drink water, the taste of water is Krishna. Now when somebody is intelligent, their intelligence is Krishna. Everything ultimately is permeated with the presence of Krishna. And then there Krishna says, ye chaiva sattvika bhava rajasas tamasas cha ye matta eveti tan viddhi natvaham teshu te mai natvaham teshu. They are not in me, I am not in them, they are in me. So this is actually a poetic ornament. I earlier said that how the Bhagavad Gita is filled with poetic ornaments. So this is one way of poetic ornament. You know, this is in English, it is called chiasmus. Chiasmus is you invert the words. So like John F. Kennedy said, ask not what the nation has done for you, ask what you have done for the nation. So you have the same words but invert them. So that's what Arjuna Krishna is doing over here. Natvaham teshu te mai. I am not in them, they are in me. So like that Krishna will do later in the 9th chapter also, in a verse he will do that. But here Krishna tells about his supreme position. And then he talks about four kinds of people who don't surrender to him. And then he talks about four kinds of people who surrender to him. Who are the four kinds of people? Those who are distressed, those who are distressed, those who are distressed, those who are distressed. Actually, there's a lecture of Srila Prabhupada where he is speaking to the hippies and he says, well, all of you hippies are not very appreciated in America because you are considered frustrated people. But he says, I appreciate you very much. He says, human life is meant to be frustrated. It is when you become frustrated with the normal way of living, you look for something higher. So broadly speaking, there are two ways people may come to spirituality. One is material life becomes so unbearable. There is so much pain in material life, I can't bear this, there must be something better. So that is artho and artharthi. Those are distress and those are desperately need money. I can't live this way, there must be something higher. But the other way, there's another way also. Another way is that people are pursuing material life and they achieve success in material life and then they realize this is unfulfilling. There must be something more. So either because material life is unbearable or material life is unfulfilling. So the jigyasu and the jnani are in that category. Right? Okay, I have knowledge, but this knowledge doesn't, this I want to know more about this. What is there? This is nothing substantial. So both ways somebody might come to Krishna. And then Krishna says, he's talking about these people and he says that, first he says, they're all Chaturvidha Bhajante Mam Jana Sukrutino Arjuna. They're all Sukrutina. And then after that he says, that among them the Jnani is the best. Because Tesham Jnani Nitya Yukta Eka Bhaktir Vishishyate, they can easily become fixed in devotion to me. Eka Bhaktir, because they're interested in developing a personal relationship with me. However, then he says, others are also good. Udara Sarva Evaite Jnanitvatmaiva Mematam. He says, all of them are Udaraha. Now, Udara means large-hearted. It's charitable. Now, normally, this word charitable we will use when somebody like gives a big donation or somebody gives a big contribution. That's what we call as charitable. And here, Krishna is talking about Sarva. Those who come to him for money. They are coming to Krishna for money, how can Krishna say they are charitable? Isn't it? Normally, if somebody gives money, you will call them charitable. But somebody comes to Krishna to ask for money, how can you call them charitable? So, Ramanujacharya gives a beautiful explanation. He says that Krishna is hungry for devotion. That although God is omnipotent, but still, there is one thing which he can't get by all his omnipotence, and that is our heart. He can't get our heart by force. He wants us to offer our devotion voluntarily to him. And he's so eager to have a personal relationship with us. So eager that even if somehow or the other, if somebody comes to Krishna, even if they're coming for money, at least, what are they doing? They are praying to Krishna. They're offering a part of their consciousness to Krishna. They're having enough faith that maybe Krishna will fulfill my desire. So in that sense, they're offering a little of their heart to Krishna. And Krishna is so grateful that they're offering that little part of their heart to Krishna. And he says, oh, you are so charitable. And he's appreciating. So Krishna is very eager for a personal relationship with each one of us. It says, Udara Sarva Evaite. They're all very charitable and they're all very dear to me. And this way, there are throughout the whole conversation that goes on in the Bhagavad Gita, there are small words which are so pregnant with such personal import. And if you just look, then we'll see, oh, there is so much personality of Krishna that is revealed over there. And the same Krishna, later on, as the chapter goes on, what does he say? Yes. Bahunam janmanam ante. After many lifetimes, they will come to me. Jnanavan mam prapadyate. But later on, we will say that Krishna says that actually you don't have to go through many lifetimes. Wherever you are, you just come to me and you will attain me. I'll talk about this when you come to the 18th chapter later. But here, in the 7th chapter, while Krishna is telling about his position, we have to see what is his purpose. He's saying, I am God, I am supreme, and I am so great. His purpose is not to simply proclaim his position. His purpose is to attract our devotion, to inspire us to offer our heart to him. And that's why he speaks this. And then, after that, the Bhagavad-gita moves to the 8th chapter. So, from the 7th chapter onward, the focus is on Krishna. Now, the 7th and 8th chapter, there is a There's an interesting discussion over there, or interesting transition over there. Suddenly at the end of the 7th chapter, Krishna says that if you can be in this consciousness at the time of death, sadhi bhutadi yagyam mam sadhi yagyam chayavidu krayana kale chimam prayana kale chimam. If at the time of death you can do this. Now we say, where did prayana kal come up? Where did that suddenly come from? Actually they are on a battlefield, so they are very much in the presence of death. But the idea is, ultimately spiritual journey, it culminates in what happens at the time of death. It doesn't terminate, it culminates. Culmination is like the highest point. So then the whole 8th chapter is about, large part is about death. So there Krishna tells that if you remember me at the time of death, you will come to me. And then he says, actually to remember me at the time of death, you will have to remember me. Remember me always. The smart sarveshu kaleshu mam anusmarayate cha. And then he gives two methods. Because if you see the 6th chapter, what had happened? Krishna had told Arjuna to practice the process of yoga. And Arjuna said, this is very difficult. Now, the point of Arjuna was that controlling the mind is very difficult. And Arjuna, Krishna had said, yes, if you practice by the right process, it's possible. But what is that right process? Krishna has not told over there. Now Krishna is coming toward that. So in the 8th chapter, Krishna tells about the process of Ashtanga Yoga. And he says, prayana prayana kale manasa chalena bruvor madhye pranam avesh samyak. Describe at the time of death, just with the process of yoga balena chaiva, with the power of yoga, fix your mind and you letting liberation by that. So he talks about the process of yoga, and then he comes to 8.14. 8.14 is the one verse in the Bhagavad-gita where Krishna says, you can easily attain me. Ananya cheta satatam yo mam smarati nityasha tasyaham sulabha partha nitya yuktasya yoginah. He says, ananya cheta satatam, those who fix their mind on me, tasyaham sulabha partha, they can easily attain me. Now this sulabha is a very significant word, because as I said in the previous chapter in 7.19, Arjuna has said, Krishna has said durlabha. He had said that bahunam janmanam ante gyanavan mam prapadyate vasudeva sarmamiti samatmasu durlabha. Those souls are very, very rare. Those who know me in truth, those who surrender to me, those who attain me are very rare. But he says over here, if you practice bhakti, sulabha, tasyaham sulabha partha, I can be easily attained. So this is Krishna glorifying the process of bhakti. He's saying if you practice bhakti, that which is very difficult will become attainable for you. That which is very rare, very difficult to attain, will be easily attained. Because bhakti attracts the grace of Krishna. And then after that, he talks about how this world is dukkhalaya. Now if you see this verse, mamupetya punarjanma dukkhalayam ashashvatam namnuvanti mahatmanah samsiddhim paramamgataha. You see, we often quote this verse, Krishna says this world is dukkhalaya. But actually Krishna is not saying the world is dukkhalaya as a stress point. Krishna stressing in that if you practice bhakti, you will go beyond this dukkhalaya world and you will attain me. So it's almost like that this world is dukkhalaya, that everybody knows. It's just okay, you can get out of this. So the point over there is, this world is a place of misery. By practicing bhakti, you can get out of this world. So that this world is a place of distress does not mean that we have to stay in distress. That this world is a place of distress does not mean we have to stay in distress. What Krishna is saying is that this world is like a hospital. In a hospital, pain is inevitable. But that doesn't mean the purpose of the hospital is to cause pain. And the purpose of the hospital is to provide the treatment by which the patient can be healed. And then what happens? The success of the hospital is that the patient goes out of the hospital. Isn't it? Not to the crematorium. But back to normal life. Similarly, Krishna says the success of the world is that the soul goes out of this world to the spiritual world. So, Krishna is telling that at the time of death, we don't leave home. At the time of death, we go home. So, it depends on what our conception of home is. If our attachment to the world is so great and we think this world and the place which I have in this place, this is my home, then death is like leaving home. But if you understand, if our attachment to Krishna has become so great that being with Krishna is what we consider as home, then at the time of death, we go home. So when he's telling this message, this world is dukkhalaya, it is not in a pessimistic mood. This world is dukkhalaya, you stay dukkhi. Not like that. Krishna is saying this world is dukkhalaya, but this world is a place of distress, but I have a process by which you can get out of this. Just follow this process and you will come out. And then again, there are many places in the Bhagavad Gita which Krishna speaks by contrast. If you do this, this will happen. If you do this, this will happen. There's one devotee who was doing some Hindu-Christian dialogue and he said, I want to write an article or a booklet on the 10 commandments of the Bhagavad Gita. Like there are 10 commandments in the Bible. I told him, please don't write such a book. He said, why? He says, the Bhagavad Gita is not a book of commandments. The Bhagavad Gita is a book of choices. Choices and consequences. Krishna is nowhere really taking the position, I am God, you have to obey me. Although Krishna is God, he is not throwing his weight around saying, you must obey me or I'll send you to hell. It's not that mood at all. Krishna is throughout having a very reasonable argument. Saying, this, if you do this, this will happen. If you do this, this will happen. And therefore, do this. So Krishna is actually, in the Bhagavad Gita, giving a map. And telling, this road, where does this road go? Where does this road go? So, you can decide where you want to go. So, what he says over here is, first, he says, in Mamupetya Punarjanma, that first he says that if you worship me, you will attain me. And then, next verse he says, Abrahma Bhuvana Alloka Punaravartino Arjuna. If, instead of worshipping me, you do anything else, wherever else you go, you will come back. But, Mamupetya Tu Kaunteya Punarjanmana Vidyate. If you worship me, you will come to me. So choices and consequences. This comes repeatedly in the Gita. Third chapter, Krishna tells Arjuna, if you do this, this will happen. That's 3.30 and 31. Those who have faith in me, those who don't have faith in me. Again, 4.39, 40 is, those who have faith in me, those who don't have faith in me. What will happen to them? That the same mood will come repeatedly by contrast. Krishna is not saying, when he says, have faith in me, he's saying that if you follow the process of devotion, this is what will happen to you. If you don't follow the process of devotion, this is what will happen to you. It's like a doctor is saying, you take this treatment, this will happen. If you don't take this treatment, this will happen. Now you do decide what you want to do. So then, the 8th chapter, when he concludes it, Krishna gives an assurance that if you practice bhakti, that then he talks briefly about the whole Vedic process of dying at the right time. That there is, should die during Uttarayan, not during Dakshinayan, and all those things like that. And Krishna says, you don't have to worry about all this. Tasmat sarveshu kaleshu yoga yukto bhava arjuna naite sruti partha janan yogi muhyati kashchana. He says, the yogi is not worried about all this. Bhakti is not about getting the right time. It is about getting the right mood. When we die is not as important as in what consciousness we die. He says, if you live in this way, then you will attain perfection. And as Krishna goes into starts asking about bhakti, speaking about bhakti, he actually goes into ecstasy. And as he goes into ecstasy, he just starts keep speaking. So that's why 6th chapter to 7th chapter, there is no driving question. At the end of the 7th chapter, there is a driving question. In the 8th chapter to 9th chapter, also, there is no driving question. Krishna has spoken about, Krishna has contrasted bhakti and yoga. And then he concludes by saying, by bhakti yoga, what will happen? Vedeshu yagyeshu tapasu chaiva daneshu yat punya phalam pradishtam atyeti tat sarvam idam viditva yogi param sthanam upaiti chadyam. The yogi will attain the supreme destiny. Which yogi? The yogi is absorbed in my mind, observed their mind in me. That is the bhakti yogi. And then as he is speaking about the glory of bhakti yoga, Krishna spontaneously goes on. And then he speaks the 9th chapter, where Bhakti Yoga is even more emphasizes. Raja Guhya is the most confidential knowledge. And in this 9th chapter, a lot of things are happening. First thing that happens is, Krishna contradicts himself. First he says, Matsthani sarva bhutani nachaham teshu avasthitaha. All living beings are situated in me. That's 9.4. And 9.5 says, Nacha matsthani bhutani pash. That. But all living beings are not situated in me. Now it's exactly contradictory. Suppose I make a statement that, okay, Krishna says this in the Bhagavad-gita. And next verse, no, Krishna doesn't say this in the Bhagavad-gita. I say, okay, I'm sorry, you know, I made a mistake. But Krishna speaks two contradictory statements and there is no mood of apology. He says, it's a mood of celebration. Pashyame yogam aishwaram. Just see my mystical opulence. He says, all living beings are situated in me, but all living beings are not situated in me. This is my mystical opulence. Now, what is Krishna saying over here by this? Krishna is telling us that his glory is inconceivable. Now, of course, our acharyas have tried to explain it in different ways. He says, Krishna is the Paramatma, is sustaining all living beings. But Krishna is Bhagavan, is in his own spiritual world. He is not carrying anyone. So, in a sense, mayatatam idam sarvam jagadavyakta murtina matsthani sarva bhutani nachaham teshu avasthitaha. This 9.4 verse is like a concise verse which tells about all three aspects of the absolute truth. Mayatatam idam sarvam jagadavyakta murtina, that is talking about the Brahman aspect. Oh, that I pervade all of existence. Matsthani sarva bhutani, all living beings are sustained in me. That is the Paramatma aspect. Nachaham teshu avasthitaha. No, I am not situated in them. That is the Bhagavan aspect. So, we have to know what Krishna is talking about. Otherwise, it can seem contradictory. When Krishna is talking, referring to himself, he is sometimes referring to different aspects of himself. Say, like if the head of state, if the prime minister or a king, they come home. Now, at that time, when they are talking about themselves, they will not talk in the mood of a prime minister. They are just talking about a family member. So, when Krishna's moods are different, at that time, Krishna talks in different ways. Even if somebody like a big commander of, they have a gun. If they go home, they will not go with that gun and show it to their family members. Their mood will be very different. So, like that, Krishna is talking in different moods. And then, after the 9th chapter, it's more or less, in some ways, a repetition of the theme of the 7th chapter, but with greater depth. Krishna talks about his great position and then the greatness of devotion to him. And there are several special verses in the Bhagavad, this 9th chapter. So, can't talk of that. One of them is that actually Krishna tells over there that if you just become devoted to me, I will protect you. Yoga kshemam vahamyaham. This assurance of protection is given so that we can just focus wholeheartedly on practicing bhakti. And then this glorification of devotion is so great. Actually, Krishna contrasts devotion to him with worship of the devatas in four different ways in this chapter. First, he says that actually whatever you gain, you will lose it. When you go to higher planets, you will fall down. Whatever you gain is temporary. But if you worship me, whatever you gain is eternal. And for worshipping the devatas, you have to perform big, big rituals. But for worshipping me, just offer me a leaf, a flower, a fruit, or a little water. The acharyas explain it is Krishna is also speaking in singular, not even plural. It's patram pushpam phalam toim. It is not even patrani pushpani phalani. Just one leaf, one fruit, one flower. So Krishna is so eager that we come to him. He says, so longevity of result, simplicity of process. And then third thing he says is, in 9.29.30, that actually speaking, you know, even if somebody is a wrongdoer, it does terrible wrong things, still that person will come to me. And then last thing he says is that even if somebody is considered conventionally lowborn, even they will come to me. So even if that person has some bad karma from previous life, or that person has done bad karma in this life, Krishna says, still if you practice bhakti, you will come to me. And that verse, apichet sudhuracharo bhajate mamananya bhak sadhureva samantavya samyag vyavasito hi saha. That no matter how wrong a thing you have done, says, if you are determined to serve me, then Krishna says, consider such a person saintly. And this is a very reassuring verse. What Krishna is telling over here is that we don't have the power to ever do anything that will make Krishna stop loving us. We don't have the power to do that. Sometimes we think, oh, I made such a big mistake. My life is ruined now. Now, yes, sometimes our mistakes may foil our plans. Now, our mistakes may foil our plans. But Krishna's plan is so big that our mistakes can never block his plan. Yes, our mistakes may have consequences. But our mistake cannot block Krishna's plan. So we shouldn't think, it's not that Krishna's plan is like a, Krishna's plan is like one straight line. And if you don't follow that line, then you are lost forever. No, it's not. Krishna's plan is like a network of paths. And even if we take a wrong turn, Krishna can guide us and bring us back on the right turn. So Krishna is saying, I love you and you cannot ever do anything that will stop me from loving you. It's like, say, if you use a GPS and GPS tells us to turn right and we turn left, then what does the GPS say? You didn't obey me, get lost. GPS doesn't do that. Immediately reroutes and tells us the way ahead. So Krishna is like the ultimate GPS. And no matter how many wrong turns we take, Krishna always reroutes and shows us the way back. So, Krishna is saying, no matter how many misdeeds you have done, just have the intention to serve me. If you have that intention to serve me, you will come to me. And somebody will say, no, this person has done terrible wrongs. Krishna says, no, if they are trying to serve me, kshipram bhavati dharmatma shashvat chantim nigachati, soon they will become purified. Kshipram. And then, Kaunteya pratijanihi name bhakta pranashyati. Name bhakta pranashyati. Krishna says, my devotee will never be destroyed. So Krishna here says that devotion is seen more in the firmness of our intention than the firmness of our action. Because sometimes our conditionings may be so strong that firmness of action might be impossible. I decide I want to do something, or I don't want to do something, and then one day, 2 days, 3 days, and then I not only forget my resolution, I also forget what was the resolution. I just succumb completely. So what happens is we may relapse. So firmness of action might not be possible for us. But firmness of intention means that when the conditionings come, they push us in a particular direction, then okay, we get pushed at that time. But as soon as that conditioning goes, that the surge goes away, we immediately come back on the right track. So, sometimes we think that our urges, you know, we have various urges, lust, anger, greed, envy. We think that urges are like a straight line. If I try to resist it, it's going to keep growing, 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 growing. And then one eventually I'm going to succumb. So, let me succumb now only. We think like that. But our urges are not like an endlessly growing line. They are not an endlessly rising line. The urges are like endlessly recurring waves. The waves will keep coming. But every wave has a crest and then it has a trough. So when the wave rises, sometimes we get swept off in the opposite direction. But as soon as the wave stops, then again we move forward in the right direction. So Krishna says, if you just maintain that right intention, he says, even if you're not able to overcome the conditionings right now, still keep practicing bhakti. If you do wrong, okay, but come back on the right track as soon as possible. He says, sadhu, such a person should be considered a good person, a saintly person. Why? Because saintliness has to be seen in action eventually. But initially, at least the intention has to be there. So Krishna is actually opening his heart over here and saying that if you just have the desire to practice devotion, you just have that intention, this is what I want to do. Even if you're not able to do it, Krishna says, I will appreciate your intention. As much as you can do, you do it. If you can't do it, I'll understand it. So Krishna is opening his heart and telling us that just come to me. Do as much as you can. And in this way, when we see this Krishna, this particular verse is not to be taken, I can do whatever I want. It's not like that. Sometimes, against what we want, we are pulled to do certain things. But we don't become disheartened. Just stay, continue practicing bhakti. Now we may fall down, but we don't have to fall away. Fall down means we want to do something, we somehow not able to do it, fall down. But fall away means we give up the path. So no matter what happens, we never give up the path. We fall down, rise and move on. We sometimes want to be, we want consistency in our devotion. Yes, but consistency is difficult. Even if we can't have consistency, we can have resiliency. We can be resilient. Okay, I fall, I'll rise again. I fall, I'll rise again. And just by that, we'll gradually become purified. Krishna says, Kshipram Bhavati Dharmatma. We'll become purified, we'll become virtuous. And by Krishna's grace, we will ultimately attain the supreme perfection. That's what Krishna shows in the last verse. Manmanabha madbhakto madhyaji mam namaskuru mame vaishyasi yuktvaivam atmanam matparayana. He says, with your heart and soul devoted to me, you will surely attain me. So this is Krishna. He is not a demanding God staying up there and saying, you come to me. Krishna is actually a descending God. He descends to this world and he wants to lift us up. He says, I will hold you by the hand. When you fall there, fall down, I will lift you again. Just come with me. There's Krishna opening his heart and calling us to come to him. Such is the beautiful heart of Krishna that is revealed in the Bhagavad Gita. So I'll quickly summarize. I don't know if I can summarize this because it's so much. But broadly, I spoke today about how the Bhagavad Gita is not just a philosophy, it is a personal conversation. And it begins with how Duryodhan's vision is, he doesn't see Krishna. And materialistic people don't think God as consequential. And God also appears in an inconsequential position. He's just a charioteer. But what happens? He is blowing his horn. Something significant is there. He's not just a charioteer. And then when Arjun desires to see from the eyes, illusion comes in. For the brain, what we take in through the eyes or take in through the mouth or through the blood is the same. It has the same effect of agitation. So Arjun gets deluded. And Krishna doesn't instruct till he's asked to instruct. Doesn't give advice till he's asked for advice. He just gives a pep talk. But when Arjun surrenders, then we need to understand what is the question. The question is not whether should I fight or not fight, is what is dharma. So he has the dharma sankat, kshatriya or kula dharma. And Arjun says, you are not a kshatriya, Krishna says, you are not a kshatriya nor a kuru, you are an atma. So test of education is in the education of emotions. And Krishna says, your emotions are not educated. And then in the second chapter, he tells about how to work with, not work or renunciation, but work with renunciation. And in the third chapter, Arjuna has this question. Krishna is talking about inner peace to relieve Arjuna of his turbulence, emotional turbulence. But Arjuna takes this into the outer peace. He says, why are you asking me to fight? And then Krishna answers again in the third chapter. And for second and third chapter, he gives glimpses of how he is not just a teacher, but he's the object of teaching. But in the fourth chapter, in response to Arjuna's question, or how did you speak to Sun God, Krishna reveals his position for 10 verses. And then again, he shifts back to the teaching of Karma Yoga. But even in that teaching of Karma Yoga, he's focusing on how should act in knowledge. And in the fifth chapter, again, he gives a hint of his devotion. He gives a hint of devotion by saying that the real peace will come not by avoiding conflict, but by harmonizing with me, by trusting me. When you say Krishna is saying that trusting God and doing His will. Surdam Sarva Bhutanam, He's our greatest well-wisher. Sixth chapter is at the same time, at one level talking about great austerities and very high levels of spiritual vision, but also talking about a very understanding Lord. Now, we need to first be understood before we can understand. So Krishna tells Arjuna, yes, it's very difficult to control the mind, but it is possible. So self-control or self-mastery is not just a matter of raw willpower. You need the right process. And then again, when Arjuna says, what if I don't complete in this life? Krishna assures, yes, you can complete. You know, if not in this life, next life. Those who do good will never be destroyed. So very reassuring tone. The seventh chapter shifts from detachment to attachment. The Bhagavad-gita initially talks about a very unemotional kind of spirituality, an unemotional kind of bhakti, because the essence of devotion is not emotion but dedication. And if emotion comes in the way of dedication, then you have to put it aside. So, but here Krishna says, shift the focus, mai asakta, focus on Krishna. And then the seventh chapter is revealing Krishna's glory so that the devotee, so that we can be inspired to surrender to Krishna. And there, udaraha, those who are asking Krishna for money, Krishna is calling them charitable, because Krishna is so eager to have our heart that is not in his power to get, although he is omnipotent. So if we offer our heart for whatever reason, Krishna feels indebted and he says, oh, you are so large hearted. And then in the 8th chapter, he talks about death and how we can remember him at the time of death. And there he assures, he contrasts the difficulty in practicing yoga with bhakti yoga is sulabha, it's very easy. And then he talks about how this world is a place of death, but you can get out of this world by practicing devotion to me. So it's not a pessimistic declaration, this world is a place of death. It's an optimistic, hope-giving declaration. You can get out of this world by practicing bhakti. Bhagavad-gita is not a book of commandments, but of choices and consequences. And then the 9th chapter especially talks about how he is glorifying devotion, the longevity of the result, the simplicity of the process, the lack of disqualification because of past bad karma or even present bad karma. And lastly, I focused on how Krishna sees devotion not so much in terms of firmness of action as in firmness of intention. So we may fall down, but we don't have to fall away. If we just rise and even if we can't be consistent, if we are resilient, then Krishna is not a demanding God, he's a descending God. He doesn't demand that we rise to him, he descends down to our level and raises up by his finger up to us. Krishna's purpose is not to catch us when we do wrong, it is purpose to catch us when we fall. Such is a loving God who is revealed through the Gita and who inspires us and invites us to surrender to him and thus attain him. Thank you very much. Shrimad Bhagavad Gita ki, Srila Prabhupada ki, Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki, Jai Gaur Premanande. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.